Bonnie, you're welcome to St. Anthony's as we gather to pray the beloved soul of Duff. I'm a senior Olivera, retired priest of our diocese, and I want to express my gratitude to Father Christopher Stanibula for allowing me the courtesy of celebrating the Mass this morning. And now, let us pray. Almighty God and Father, it is our certain faith that your Son who died on the cross was raised from the dead, the first fruits of all who have fallen asleep. Grant that through this mystery, your servant Duff, who has gone to his rest in Christ, may share in the joy of his resurrection. And we ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. Be seated for our first reading.
They seemed, in the view of the foolish, to be dead, and their passing away was thought an affliction, and their going forth from us utter destruction, but they are in peace. For if before men indeed they be punished, yet is their hope full of immortality. Chastised a little, they shall be greatly blessed, because God tried them and found them worthy of himself. As gold in the furnace, he proved them, and as sacrificial offerings, he took them to himself. Those who trust in him shall understand truth, and the faithful shall abide with him in love, because grace and mercy are with his holy ones, and his care is with his elect.
The Lord. Thanks be to God.
Nothing indeed shall
second reading is a reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. None of us lives for oneself, and no one dies for oneself. For if we live, we live for the Lord, and if we die, we die for the Lord. So then, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. For this is why Christ died and came to life, for that he might be the Lord of both the dead and the living. For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of God, for it is written, As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bend before me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. And then each of us shall give an account of himself to God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Thank you.
Catholicism on the sleeve, but he was fed at this altar. so that he could be an example of Christ by what he did, what he said, how he treated you. With respect, with understanding, with love, with forgiveness. And that's what we celebrate today as we gather once again to hear God's word, to break the bread, to be nourished that we may go forth to see him, to live with him, to see him in others, and eventually be with him in that kingdom of light, of happiness, and of peace. You know, the longer I live, which I hope is a little longer, I believe there are no coincidences. I think it's God's incidents. God provides the right time and the right place. Last year, very often, Mark and Carol, and Carol, Bishop Cronin's niece, and Mark Finley's her husband, and while he's down the Cape, they always invite us to their home for a gathering in the summer. Fortunately, they still remember me. I knew them when they were, before they were teenagers, actually. And I met Duff there a couple of times, and at one point, three of us always get together Friday night to encourage one another. We used to meet at Mike's, but we got changed, so we meet someplace else. Whenever I saw Duff one, I searched him out, and it was always at Michael's, probably at the bar having a meal. Maybe a little glass of ginger ale, I don't know. So last year, Mark said, you know, he's on your way home, he's not driving, do you mind taking him home? I said, no. He happened to. We had a delightful conversation. I dropped him off, I knew where it was. Well, Ascension Thursday, and I had said Mass in the morning, helping out another priest. Usually I try to every weekend. But anyway, I don't mind. And I was saying to myself, you know, if I knew where Duff lived, I'd stop in and say hello. Well, I knew where he lived, but I didn't know the number. And I dropped him off, it was dark, and he didn't want any help in the house. Just as I was thinking that, I get a call from Carolyn. She said, you know, Duff is still hanging on, he's not doing too well. I said, you know, I was just thinking about seeing him. I said, give me the number, and I will go and say hello. Well, they texted me, nobody calls you back, but they texted me, I knew where we lived, and I went. And I said, by the way, I'm not dressed as a priest, so tell them I'm not a full of brush salesman, that I am coming. I don't know what a full of brush is, but I mean. So I went, his lovely daughter just left for the first time, so I missed meeting her at that point in time. A lovely nurse greeted me and went into the room where Duff was, the two men were with him. And I said, Duff, it's Monsignor Oliveira. And he sort of opened his eyes like he knew that I was there. And I thought that maybe Ascension Thursday would be a good day to die. If the Lord went up to heaven, Duff would go that same day. No day is a good day to die, and no day is a bad day to die. But he waited, as you said, Mother's Day, the month of Mary, month of Mary to go home to his heavenly mother. So he prayed the Our Father. And then I said the prayer for the commendation of the dying. The last time I said it was to my mother, and I couldn't really see through my tears. We had just celebrated Trinity Sunday, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The first words, we probably don't hear them, but the first words that were said for us in church as we were baptized, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Father who loved you sent his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to save us, and sent forth his Spirit to guide us and to sanctify us. That's the first prayer we learn. And I was at St. Mary's, the baptismal font, the holy water font was at the entrance of the church. And I always love to see the parents come in with the kids in their arms and teach them how to bless themselves. And if we are fortunate enough, as Duff was, we'll hear these words at the end of our life. Go forth, Christian soldier, Christian soul from this world. In the name of God, the Almighty Father who created you. In the name of Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, who suffered for you. In the name of the Holy Spirit, who was poured out upon you. Go forth, faithful Christian. May you live in peace this day. May your home be with God in Zion, with Mary, the Virgin Mother of God, with Joseph, all the angels and saints. I commend you, my dear brother Duff, to Almighty God, and entrust you to your Creator. May you return to Him who formed you from the dust of the earth. May Holy Mary, the angel, and all the saints come to meet you as you go forth from this life. May Christ, who was crucified for you, bring you freedom and peace. May Christ, who died for you, admit you into the garden of paradise. May Christ, the true shepherd, acknowledge you as one of his flock. May he forgive you all your sins and set you among those he has chosen. May you see your Redeemer face to face and know the, and enjoy the vision of God forever and ever. And we pray together, the Abba Father. And so we give Duff back to you, O Lord, who first gave him to us. And as you did not lose him in the return, so we do not lose him by his return. What is yours is ours also if we belong to you. Love is unending. And the boundary of this mortal life is but a horizon. An horizon, nothing save the limit of our sight. So lift us up, strong Son of God, that we may see more clearly. And while you prepare a place for us, prepare us also for that happy place that we may be with you, with Jeff, and those we love forevermore. May his noble soul rest in God's eternal peace. Please stand for the prayer of faith. Brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church. Confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we join our prayers to his this morning.
Responses, Lord, hear our prayer. For Duff, whose faith sustained him during his earthly life, that he may be received by the saints with love and joy into the eternal dwelling place prepared for him, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Duff's family, that they may be given hope, peace, consolation. Treasuring the memories that they have of him, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who work with the sick and the aged, and for all those who attend to the needs of Duff, that they may be granted the grace, patience, understanding needed to continue the compassionate care, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the deceased relatives and friends of Duff, especially to his late parents, that the peace and happiness of heaven may be theirs forever, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all gathered here to worship in faith, that the bond which unite us may be strengthened as we look forward in hope to being united one day in the kingdom of heaven, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In the silence of our hearts this morning, let us add our own particular needs and intentions. Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer, Jesus Christ, and the voices of your people whose lives are purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ, and grant them a place in the kingdom. And we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Duff. We beseech your mercy, that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection is found, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended, and when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glories without end. We acclaim. Filled with His Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May you make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Edgar, our bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own.
Listen graciously to this family whom you have gathered before you this morning at St. Anthony. In your compassion and mercy, Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant Duff, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he was united with your son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in flesh those who have died and transform our lowly bodies after the pattern of his own glory. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who are pleasing to you in the passing of this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There, we hope and enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages, and praise you without end. Through Christ our Lord, for whom you bestow in the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty, Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen. should enter into my roof, but only say the word, my soul shall be healed.
At this point, Holy Communion, Catholics who are properly disposed are invited to come to Holy Communion. Other Catholics and non-Catholics are invited to come for a blessing. Simply cross your hands over your chest.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is John Fish. I'm a former student athlete at Tabor Academy, class 1978. G. Richard Duffy is my JV football and varsity baseball coach at Tabor Academy. He was also my mentor, father figure, role model, and friend. We all knew this day was coming. Coach Duffy battled cancer for many years, and his five bouts with his deadly disease continued to take their toll on his physical and mental well-being. We did our best to prepare for this day, but we still knew we'd really never be ready. Duff also knew this day was coming, but unlike us, he was prepared. In fact, he had planned this entire mass and celebration of life back in 2005, and he was perfectly healthy 20 years ago. I'm sure it would not surprise you that Duff left us clear step-by-step instructions on how he wanted this day to proceed. Upon my death, call Jay Waring, 713-577-777. One day wake, three. Next day at St. Anthony's, family and friends only. Four, songs, Danny Boy and Faith of Our Fathers. Five, burial at St. Patrick's in Fall River with Mom and Dad. Six, party after the burial. Eat, drink, and be merry. Make it a party that I would want to attend. It took me a while to realize it. What Coach Duffy had left us was a playbook, his funeral playbook. If anyone who ever played for Duff, would be football, baseball, or squash, you knew there was no choice but to follow his playbook. Otherwise, we would be on the receiving end of the infamous Duffy look. Surly eyes, squinted expression, tight lips. Picture an angry Clint Eastwood wearing tape of a baseball cap on backwards with plastic sweats, fungal bat in his hand with his cleats on. Obedience with Duff was a must. If you didn't follow his instructions or execute, he would poke his finger in your chest, a feeling that you would never forget. He wanted to see what you were made of. And at first, you wouldn't think you were made of much. But then, you'd begin to realize your worth. Over time, the better you performed, the more confident you would become in your preparation, in your physical and mental capabilities, and in your future. All along, Duff had a method to his madness. His hardcore approach to coaching was part of his master plan to make you tougher and prepare you for life's challenges. But most importantly, his approach made you believe in yourself, especially when nobody else did. This was how he took immature, inexperienced high school boys and postgraduates and molded them into men. When I was younger, being on the receiving end of the Duffy look was never, never a good thing. But now as an adult, when I realize I've seen that look for the very last time, I know I'll miss it forever. Duff believed in playbooks, and he believed in practice. He understood that repetition led to the pursuit of perfection, which in turn leads to success. Similar to legendary football coach Nick Saban, Duff was all about the process. Practices lasted for hours, focusing on the fundamentals. It felt more like a track and field practice than football practice. In fact, we ran 3 times Tom longer in the Tabor Academy track. And I'd argue we could probably beat them. Sprints would begin the moment Duff would shout his favorite phrase. Hands on the line. Do it. When Duff barked those orders, we would do what we were told to do because we believed in Duff. Those who didn't believe him, played soccer. No offense, I'm sorry.
He taught his students
with a strong dose of reality and social responsibility. He introduced real stories and real people to his students. He often invited Vietnam veterans like Richard Ginty into his classroom to talk about his horrific experiences from the war. Duff wanted students to learn about the Vietnam War from someone who was there to help them understand the true meaning of loyalty, patriotism, and sacrifice. I have my own memories of Duff, far too many to count. Ironically, after knowing Duff my entire life, one of my greatest memories of Duff occurred during the final visit with him. A few weeks ago, I received a phone call from his nurse who told me Duff was declining. When I saw him, I walked slowly up to the bedside, reached down, and hugged him. I hugged him tightly with both hands and held him close to me as if my life depended on it. Like he taught us to do with Walt. I promised myself I would never take him for granted, knowing it could be the last time I might see him alive. And I told him I love him. Three words I never used with him before. Three words that oftentimes have been uncomfortable for me to say to anyone. He hugged me back, and he held on, and he said, he loved me too. Words he has never used with me before until that moment. It was a beautiful moment. It was well worth the wait, and one that I will cherish for the rest of my life. So why am I here in front of you today, honoring Duff? Duff coached young people for more than 50 years during the most impressionable years of their lives. I am honored to have been one of those people. When I entered Tabor Academy in 1974, I was unable to read, write, spell clearly. I had severe learning disabilities of dyslexia, and my test scores were terrible. Tabor was the only school that would accept me. The dream of having academic abilities and confidence was an unachievable dream for me. At that time, until met Jim Richard Duffy. Duff helped me ignore my insecurities and introduced me to the game of football and the game of teamwork. Duff often disciplined in repetition on the field, kept me focused, and helped me ignore distractions that could easily have gotten my way. But most importantly, Duff saw something in me that I did not see in myself. Work ethic, leadership, competitiveness, and mental toughness. All along, his message in words and his actions was, if you're willing to put forth the work, believe in yourself, you can achieve anything. You can make the impossible possible. He taught me my strengths in the field could translate to strengths in the classroom, strengths in business, and strengths in life. My very first time Coach Duffy walked onto the field and entered my world, there has never been a day I have not thought of him or his words of wisdom. Coach Duffy saved my life. That is why I stand in front of you today. But I am far from alone. Many of you have your own countless tough stories that are worth sharing with this world. I represent all of you and all the individuals who were saved by Coach Duffy because he believed in you, coached you, and loved you. Now, we must ask ourselves, how do we carry forward Duff's legacy forever. To me, the answer is simple. We must continue his work. We all must take responsibility for our young people and look for teaching moments to prepare the next generation for life's challenges. We must seek out young people who need positive role models and mentor them and guide them. We must help others believe in themselves, even in the darkest moments. We must speak from the heart and do what we feel is right, even when our opinions might seem unpopular. We must love our country and never, never take for granted the freedoms we hold dear, just as Duff taught us. Coach Duffy, it's now time to put away your whistle and begin your final run to a much better place. Hands on the line. Do it. You certainly did it, Duff. You did it for all of us. And because you did, we will remember you forever. God bless you, Duff. God bless America. Rest in peace.
Zero reason for being there. We don't even know what that school was to this day. Each class was called to come to the front of the auditorium and climb up on stage and have their picture taken with the trophy. And Duff slid in behind a bunch of third graders. We're trying to figure out, who is this guy? We don't know him. He doesn't know us. He is not our teacher. And Duff pushed his way to the front, boxed down these confused kids to be right front and center with that trophy. Right where he wanted to be. And no doubt, as he left, he ordered an equally confused picture taker, send me a copy of that. And clearly they did, because it was framed in our house. People always comply with the Duff demand. So my dad is forever immortalized with this group of third grade strangers, but more importantly, with his beloved Red Sox winning trophy. And to me, it sums my dad up perfectly, and it highlights my personal favorite things about him. For starters, his sense of humor. I thought he was the funniest person ever. A total rascal, a twinkle in his eye, a contagious laugh that fills the room, a love for mischief and fun, and he never lost his inner child. In fact, some people might say he led with it. But everything I learned about comedy, I learned by watching my dad move through this world. His laugh will always be one of my absolute favorite sounds. Because of him, wherever I go, I have a knack for finding rascals. And life has been 100% more interesting because of that. And only a rascal would have taken this picture. Second, perseverance. My dad believed, never let anyone tell you if you can't accomplish something. If you want it bad enough and you're willing to work hard to get it, anything can be done. Duff believed you grind hard after your goals. After all, a river cuts through rock not through its power, but through its persistence. It's the one thing I hear his players and alumni say about him, and he fought cancer forever. But that gave him so much more time with the people he loved. And I actually think he thought he could still beat it all the way up until the end. In fact, some of his amazing nurses, he had the best team of nurses, they said to me, Kate, you know, at the end, you might want to give him permission to go. Tell him it's okay to leave, that sometimes people hang on to hear that. And so I had sat with him for a while, and he had been a little bit unresponsive. And I had been telling him through the week, I love you, Dad, you're my best friend, I'm going to miss you forever. But I couldn't get that last part out, that it was okay to go. I couldn't do it. So I'm sitting there, and I say all the things I want to say. I love you, Dad, I'm going to miss you, you're my best friend. And then I said the thing. I said, it's okay to go. I'm going to be okay, be at peace. And in that moment, his eyes shot open. And he looked at me and said, what are you talking about, Katie? I loved his bite. My dad also had a healthy disrespect for rules and authority. In Duff world, there was no rules that couldn't be bent. I can't tell you how many times throughout my whole life I found myself in some sketchy situations saying, Dad, I don't think we're supposed to be here. Or, I think we need a ticket for this. Or, I'm pretty sure this is private property. In fact, when I went to Fenway South with him every March, he would drive his rental car to the strip mall and park right underneath a giant sign that said, no parking. And he would turn to me and say, Katie, here's what I need you to do. I want you to go into that chocolate shop, pretend you're buying something, then slip out the side door. I'll meet you by the marsh. We're going to walk through it. We're going to end up in the back of the lot. We'll stand by a car so the shuttle picks us up. I said, Dad, can't we just pay $5 to park in the lot? He says, we're not paying $5 to park in the lot, Katie. them. He played with the other faculty kids in the dining hall, each one in their own signature Duff game, from I got your nose to Buzzy Bee to why won't you let go of my hand. They loved him, and he adored them. One time at a family wedding, he got the ring bearer so excited that the kid peed his pants. And Duff immediately escaped into the church, leaving that issue to be somebody else's problem. And with his students, I always knew my dad spent 46 years teaching and coaching, but it was way more than that. He spent 46 years caring, helping to build character, helping students believe in themselves, helping them become their own best versions of themselves. From all the notes through the years and in his passing, one thing was really clear to me. A teacher does affect eternity, and Duff's legacy will live on a long time. I have a distinct but distant memory of coming home from dinner one night, and there was a student, I can't remember who it was, but he was sitting on the steps waiting for Duff. He had lost his dad, and he needed some support. Duff picked him up, brought him into the house, and talked to that kid late into the night. After all, it was something he could really relate to. He was constantly doing things like that. He was really tough, but he loved a lot. I shared my dad with a lot of people. Sometimes I didn't always understand. But he walked in his purpose every day, and he wouldn't do one thing differently. And that purpose was to be of service to others and to his students. He loved it. He was of and for the world. These kids in this picture, they don't know him, but I am sure he made a lasting impression. Finally, this picture reminds me of the dedication and love he had for this whole community. Over 50 years in this tri-town area. Only in this area would a strange man be able to walk into a school and just take pictures with kids. It's a tribute to small town living. He left the keys in his ignition, he left his house unlocked, and his door was always open to everyone at all times. It took a village to raise a Duff. He was never alone. People were constantly stopping by, reaching out, inviting him to be a part of their families, their holidays, their lives. From Duff Day, where nobody gets a speeding ticket in his honor, or the Duff namesake fleet of kayaks at Silvershell Beach, to the Duffy Fields. He left a huge indelible mark on this community and the community on him. The week leading up to his passing was an amazing living wake that only Duff could orchestrate. 9 days of just constant visitors. My supportive husband was moving my mother into a care facility which allowed me to be here with this amazing team of nurses who have become part of our family. A steady stream of people came by. They sent letters, they sent videos, they said goodbye, they brought food, they retold stories, they laughed, they cried. They were being there for each other, and for me, and for my dad in his final moments. It was true community, and it was extended family, and for me, it's what life is all about. It was my dad's last gift to me, you all, his loving, loyal community. During that time, my uncle wrote me a note to say, why would he leave? He's surrounded by so much love. It was so true. There are too many people to thank individually in this moment, but I want you to know I will thank you all individually at some point. Nothing has gone unnoticed. Nothing. I am grateful for all of it, all the ways people showed up for us. Thank you, all of you. But I would be remiss if I didn't thank two people. One, Jay Weary. My dad always said, Kate, when I buy the ranch, call Jenny. And Jay and his amazing team and Kim Perry, they did all of his wishes perfectly, and then some. Thank you. And of course, the Fish family. There is no end to my gratitude for all that you did for my dad. Having you in my corner through the ups and downs of my dad's health through the years was unbelievable and so comforting. I used to joke with my dad about John. I said, I'm an only child and still not your favorite. And you know what? He would always laugh, but then not correct him. But in seriousness, John, my dad was so incredibly proud of you, like so many in this room. You were like sons to him. With John, he would light up every single time he talked about you. And he talked about you a lot. To wrap up, I wanted to share two notes from my dad. A few years ago, I was living in LA. I flew back home so we could go over his wishes for his end of life. And we did everything but that. We had a great weekend, and then it's about an hour before I was supposed to leave for the airport. And he started looking for his will. Clearly, John had it. He rummaged through his desk, cursing, because he couldn't find it. We found a receipt to my aunt from 1987 that still had mimeograph paper in it, but no important documents. But we did, at one point, find it. He said, aha, I got it. And he handed me a cocktail napkin. With a single sentence written on it that said, make it a party I want to attend. So you all have your marching orders. And the other note was from Lee Carey. A lot of you know how important Steve Carey was in my dad's life. And she sent me a picture of a card that my dad had written Steve after he'd been honored at Pingree. And it was a beautiful note of friendship. And I just wanted to share a section of that card because in a way, I believe that there's a message directly from Duff to all of us in it. He said, my friend, we have experienced some wonderful times together, and these super times will remain with me forever. Keep fighting, my friend, and enjoy each moment we have been allotted on this planet. With loyalty and love, Duff.
Thank you for those beautiful reflections, and now let us pray. Into your hand, O Lord, we humbly entrust our brother Duff. In this life, you embraced him with your tender love. Deliver him now from every evil, and bid him enter eternal rest. The old daughter has passed away. Welcome him then into paradise, for there will be no sorrow, no weeping, no pain, but the fullness of peace and joy with your Son and the Holy Spirit forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Good Lord, Spirit.
Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother Duff. May our farewell express our affection for him. May these our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. We now incense the body with the temple of the Holy Spirit, and as the smoke rises to the top of this church as a symbol of our prayers rising to the Lord for Duff this morning.
Come to the Lord, save us.
into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Duff, with a sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Duff in his life for over 80 years. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints of Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers this morning. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with the assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you, with our brother Duff forever. And we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Duff, may the angels lead you to paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. In peace now, we'll take our brother to his place of rest.
Amen.
My favorite.